Warm greetings. The following tutorial will cover splenic masses. It's not meant to be comprehensive, but I'll go through a few benign and malignant lesions that you may encounter in the spleen. And as it turns out, with most of these lesions, I'll give you some pointers to be able to recognize them, but a lot of them will have non-specific imaging appearances. First one I'm going to talk about is hemangioma. Now, hemangiomas are going to be the most common benign splenic tumor. So if you have to just guess and you see an enhancing splenic mass, most commonly it's going to end up being a hemangioma. They're variable in size, but often small, and almost always will be incidental, and most often they'll be solitary. But if you do see multiple, you can see them in certain syndromes, such as Klippel-Trenino-Weber syndrome, so that's something you can look out for in those particular instances. And the imaging appearance, while non-specific, typically will have quite hyper-intense T2 signal, and when you give contrast, there'll be some degree of peripheral enhancement with centripetal fill-in, much like hemangioma seen in the liver. But it's important to remember that the classic appearance of the hemangioma in the liver, where you see that discontinuous peripheral nodular enhancement, is not always present in the spleen. It's sort of more variable in the spleen, but you will see an enhancing mass out in the periphery at starts and then sort of centripetally fills in over time. These are benign lesions with very few complications and, in general, something you don't need to worry about. The next lesion that I'll talk about is the hamartoma. This is very, very rare, certainly much, much less common than the hemangioma. And this is something that's going to be very difficult to diagnose prospectively based on imaging. You're going to end up seeing this most commonly as an incidental mass within the spleen, often is a solitary mass, though you can see multiple in certain syndromes, such as tuberous sclerosis and Wiskock-Aldrich syndrome. And really, as I said, going to be incidental. They're not going to present with symptoms. They're not going to cause any real symptoms for the patient. So that's reasonably reassuring. And histologically, they really just end up being an anomalous mixture of normal elements of splenic tissue, much as hamartomas anywhere. Now, the imaging appearance can be variable, quite iso-intense to the spleen on the T1-weighted images. On the T2-weighted images, it tends to be slightly hyper-intense, but overall has somewhat of a heterogeneous appearance. And when you give contrast, there is uniform, prompt, and quite avid enhancement. And so that's one way you can differentiate that from a hemangioma, which generally has more peripheral enhancement, peripheral nodule enhancement, and fills in. While hamartomas, when you give contrast from the get-go, they're going to be enhancing pretty much homogeneously, and the entirety of the lesion will enhance. Next lesion I'm going to talk about is something called a SANT. It's a sclerosing angiomatoid nodular transformation. Now, this is something that is rare. It's something that in the big scheme of things has been recently recognized as a discrete entity. So as I said, very uncommon. And internally, it really has components that are made up of the vascular tissue of the spleen, as well as additional stromal elements that compose this lesion. Most commonly, like many of the splenic lesions, these are going to be incidental masses that you end up seeing, and they're also most commonly going to be solitary. The borders of these lesions tend to be reasonably well defined and circumscribed. The outer aspect of it tends to be smooth or mildly lobulated, so that's something you can look out for. Because of vascular elements within the spleen, they can undergo internal bleeding, and that manifests as T2 signal within it, that tends to be more hypo-intense. So that's one way you can potentially differentiate this from a hamartoma and a hemangioma, which has a relatively brighter T2 signal. Certainly a hemangioma does. And when we give contrast, this tends to demonstrate peripheral enhancement and has these almost radiating septa that come out to the center. And it has this sort of, as a result, the spoke wheel enhancement. And the central portion of it, there tends to be, or there can be, a non-enhancing scar-like area. And so that's something to look out for, this sort of peripheral enhancement with internal strands that radiate centrally in that spoke wheel pattern to the scar, which doesn't enhance. The other lesion that's relatively rare in the spleen is this littoral cell angioma. And this is a benign lesion, though there have been case reports that it has undergone malignant transformation. That's something just to keep in the back of your head. And like SANT, this also is composed of some of the vascular elements of within the spleen. So it's considered somewhat of a vascular neoplasm. Like many of the lesions already discussed, this is most commonly seen incidental, so you'll just sort of pick up this lesion on imaging. And as opposed to SANT, which tends to be solitary, littoral cell angioma tend to be multiple. So if you're going to see multiple masses One thing to keep in your back of the head is literal cholangioma, particularly if it has a T1 and T2 appearance of relative hypointensity. And again, because of those vascular elements within it, a hemosiderin can develop, giving that T1 and T2 hypointense appearance. And when we give contrast in these patients, these lesions will demonstrate progressive homogeneous enhancement. So if you're seeing multiple masses, relatively dark T2 signal, homogeneous enhancement, one thing to think about is going to be a literal cell angioma. Now again, like SANT, this is going to be very difficult to diagnose prospectively based on imaging, though you can certainly suggest it. Move on to some malignant lesions. Lymphoma is certainly something that can be seen in the spleen, most commonly as a secondary tumor in the context of quite widespread disease elsewhere. Primary splenic lymphoma can also be seen. That tends to be a little bit less common. Most often when you see lymphoma in the spleen, as I said, there is disease elsewhere, or more systemic disease. And on imaging, this can really have a variety of appearances. Generally, the masses that you end up seeing will be hypodense or hypointense, and will have low-level enhancements. So these aren't going to be masses that have very brisk enhancement when you give contrast. And they can certainly manifest as a single lesion within the spleen, multiple lesions, which often look similar in appearance, hypodense, not that vascular. Can also manifest as many small nodules within the spleen. So in the right clinical history, lymphoma can certainly have that look within the spleen. You can diagnose that potentially prospectively. And one of the more common imaging appearances is generalized splenomegaly. So generally, we think the spleen upper normal is about 13 centimeters in craniocaudate dimension, and that starts to enlarge in the context of known lymphoma. Got to be worried about lymphomatous involvement of the spleen. Metastases, so within the spleen, tend to be uncommon. And when you do end up seeing them, it's often seen in the context of more widespread disease elsewhere within the body. You should certainly look out for splenic involvement in any primary lesion, but particularly when the patient has primary lung cancer, breast cancer, melanoma, look out for the spleen. These can go to spleen more often than some of the other primary lesions. Now, these masses that you end up seeing are often solid and can really have a variety of appearances, but may also have a more cystic appearance. And so don't be surprised by that, particularly with melanoma, can have a cystic appearance within that lesion. Now, angiosarcoma is a very rare lesion. It can occur in the spleen as a primary malignancy, and unfortunately, poor prognosis in these patients. Often when it's seen, there's widespread disease elsewhere in the body. And the imaging appearance is going to be very hard to call prospectively, but potentially you can suspect it in a person without any other disease elsewhere, as a heterogeneous, rather large mass in the spleen tends to have a variable appearance on T1 and T2, can be have areas of hemorrhage making a T1 bright, can have areas of necrosis making a T2 bright as well. And there'll be some heterogeneous enhancement associated with the soft tissue components of this lesion. There may be associated splenomegaly. At times, when it gets so large, it may even breach the capsule, resulting in some areas of splenic rupture. So, as I said, very uncommon lesion, but if it see a very heterogeneous lesion with areas of hemorrhage, necrosis, abutting the spleen, and perhaps even breaching the splenic capsule without really a known primary disease elsewhere, this may be something to think about. And the last lesion I'll talk about is actually go back to the benign set of lesions, is a lymphangioma. So this is benign, and it's a lesion that's often seen in younger patients, typically childhood, and really has a cystic appearance, and it can manifest on imaging as a unilocular cyst. It can be a multilocular cystic lesion. There's multiloculated lesion, can have these septations that sort of go within the lesion itself. The periphery of the mass may have areas of calcification. That's something to look out for as well. And within the spleen itself, these lesions may be solitary. You can also see them as multiple lesions. And location-wise, reported that there is a tendency for it to be subcapsular, but really can be anywhere. So if you see sort of a multiloculated, septated, cystic mass, perhaps abutting the capsule, with no internal enhancement, you're going to think about possibility of a lymphangioma. Thank you for your attention.